Good morning. On behalf of the Fulbright family, I want to thank you, every one of you, for taking time today to help us remember and celebrate the life of Rob Fulbright. Loving husband, devoted father, good friend, inspiring leader. These are just some of the words that people have used this week when describing Rob. I am grateful to have known him personally. He excelled at everything he did. Rob had a passion for life and felt a responsibility to his ultimate role as a follower of Christ. Every day, Rob did his best to live out the healing ministry of Christ, and he did it exceptionally well. He defined his work with us at Adventist Health System as the platform from which he would inspire, lead, and love others. As an executive, Rob was always looking for ways to take care of his people. He introduced ministry into daily activities and created a culture that encouraged people to do the best at what they were able to do. He had an inherent restless nature, and he was never satisfied with the status quo. Rob sought out ways to continually get closer to people, and he was called to lead so he could make a difference in their lives. At a recent meeting, I recall Rob asking a question as we reviewed one of our programs. He was seeking to ensure that we had optimized our opportunity to help people know more about Christ. We would all do well to look more closely for those moments in our life. Everywhere Rob went, things improved and people noticed. Today, this place is full of testimonies to that fact. While all these things I have shared about Rob's work is impressive, the most important part of Rob's life are the five ladies that he shared his most important roles with as husband and father. His love for his family would light up his face when he started talking about his girls. Over the years, we had many chances to talk. He told me once that he would rather be running around taking his five girls to the mall than doing anything else. As a family, the Fulbrights bring a sense of community and celebration to the lives of others. From their musical talents to their hospitality, they use their gifts to serve people and to praise God. If you ever saw Rob at one of his girls' musical performances, their sporting events, or just hosting families at their home, you saw him where he wanted to be. I'm going to miss Rob. The pain of his loss has been overwhelming this week. However, he leaves an outstanding legacy that we will always remember. Thank you, Rob. I cannot wait to laugh with you again someday in a much far better place.
Yvonne, Allie, Sophie, Bella, Victoria, Rodney, and Harriet, and all the family, and all of us whom Rob loved and adopted as friends, this week we've been reminded of how quickly life can make a seismic shift and everything in our world change. Our hearts are breaking for your loss, for our loss. When life hurts this much, no matter how far prayer may have been on the periphery of our lives, in times like this, we cry out to God. And so as we begin this service, join me as we seek God and ask for his divine consolation, comfort, and care right now. Let's pray. Father, you are good, and your love endures forever. In our more sane moments, we remember it was never your plan, never your desire, never your will that we should know the pain of grief we feel today. You are the God of life and joy and peace, and we only suffer today because of the enemy of all good, who still prowls about your world like a hungry lion, seeking whom he may devour. This is not your doing. Father, we don't understand why evil still exists. We don't understand why post-Jesus' resurrection that we'll celebrate this weekend, we haven't already stepped into the promised eternity where there'll be no more pain or suffering, no more tears, no more loss, no more sin, and no more death. We are tired, Lord, of this world. And maybe more than at any other moment in our lives right now, we long for the promised return of your Son, Jesus. Father, in these next few minutes together, even as we are sunk in the sorrow of his death, we want to honor your Son, Rob, that in our remembering we might find some comfort. You did a good thing for your world when, partnering with Rodney and Harriet, you brought Rob life. It's a better place, and we are better people for his presence, and Rob's goodness makes our pain of loss even more acute. But as good as your Son Rob was, he was clear that his confidence was not in his goodness. In fact, he knew that in him there was no saving goodness at all. We praise you that your Holy Spirit convicted Rob to put all of his hope and all of his confidence in the reality of your Son Jesus' perfect goodness, and that you credit that goodness to Rob's scorecard. So now we have hope today because Rob was absolutely perfect in Christ. Thank you for your assurance that he is safe for all eternity in Jesus. What a comfort and great legacy for his family. And now, Father, in these next few minutes together, may the words and music and pictures we share celebrate your Son, Rob, in whom you are well pleased. And may you give comfort and peace beyond our understanding to Yvonne, the girls, all the family and friends. And may your name be honored as we remember Rob. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
My privilege to share his family's story with those of you that called him friends. On behalf of Yvonne and Allie and Sophie and Bella and V and Rodney and Harriet, Mike, Michelle, and Shauna, I would like to thank you for being a part of this celebration of a life truly lived well. To all of you, he was maybe a friend, a colleague, maybe even a mentor. To those of us who called him family, he was devoted husband, father, brother, and perhaps favorite uncle. He was born Robert Don Fulbright to Rodney and Harriet Fulbright on July 22, 1969 in Siloam Springs, Arkansas. Most of you have probably not heard of Siloam Springs, Arkansas. Most people haven't. But in ways, it was the perfect place for Rob to spend the first 10 years of his life. Those years were spent in and around Ozark Adventist Academy in Gentry, Arkansas, where his dad was a physical education teacher. It was while growing up and watching his father's devotion to his students that Rod began to learn the value of servant leadership that many of you would witness so well in his professional life. In those years, he also spent countless hours trying to keep up with older brother Mike and friends like Rory and Rhodey and Billy on the basketball courts and wiffle ball courts and football fields and hills and streams around Gentry. But above all else, those first few years centered on the Fulbright family. Today, you're going to hear a lot about the family man that Rob was. That story cannot be told without understanding where his passion for family came from. Rob's parents, Rodney and Harriet, gave their four children the greatest gift any parents could give, the gift of family. It was from them that Rob learned to be the father he would go on to be to his own four children. The legacy of family that Rob leaves behind began all those years ago with you, Mom and Dad. The Fulbright name has always simply been synonymous with family. In 1979, the family relocated to Apopka, Florida, where his father accepted a position teaching at Forest Lake Academy. This community would become home. Rob attended Forest Lake Academy, where he graduated in 1988. He then went on to graduate with a double major in accounting and marketing from Southern Adventist University in Collegedale, Tennessee. Throughout his educational years, Rob began to hone the leadership skills that would serve him so well in life as he served as religious activities president of his high school and later on student body president for his college. The friends that he made in those years shaped his value of authentic relationships. Davy Joe, John, Bob Martin, Brad, Tim, and I'm sure we're leaving out countless others, you all meant the world to Rob. It didn't matter that maybe you haven't talked to him in a few years. He still loved you. It was also during his 4 years at Southern Adventist University that Rob met the love of his life, Yvonne Susan Gibson, and they were married on December 22, 1992 in Middletown, Kentucky. Rob and Yvonne's love story could be described as maybe a real-life fairy tale. It was simple, but also extravagant. It was deeply passionate, yet filled with a light-hearted joy. Their relationship was built on Jesus, but spent serving others. Over the years, Rob and Yvonne developed hearts that beat in one for God, for each other, and for their growing family. They became an unwavering team and completed each other fully. Rob simply took care of Yvonne. He would consistently lavish her with love through daily sweet gestures. His words were filled with phrases like, "I'm crazy in love with you. You're the other side of me. You're the best thing that ever happened to me. And how on earth did I get so lucky?" He simply made her feel loved and completely adored, and she did the same for him. Rob began his professional career with Adventist Health Systems at the Tennessee Christian Medical Center in Madison, Tennessee, with the managed care department. It was during this time that Rob completed his Master's of Business Administration at Tennessee State University. Rob and Yvonne relocated to Orlando, Florida in 1996. And for the past 21 years, Rob has served the Central Florida medical community as an administrator and executive officer at the Winter Park, Kissimmee, DeLand, Altamont Springs, and Orlando campuses of Florida Hospital, and most recently as the CEO of the East Region of Adventist Healthcare. For those of you who had the privilege of interacting with Rob on a professional basis and working alongside of him, you were blessed to witness his commitment to the servant leadership he learned from his father. Rob had this gift to balance his role as administrator as well as his passion for excellence with a spirit of compassion and a true commitment to people. But while Rob excelled in his professional life, his true passions lied at home. On August 17, 2000, Rob and Yvonne became the proud parents of Alexandra Susan. We call her Allie. The birth of Allie established somewhat of a tradition in the Fulbright family, because Yvonne invited all of us into the delivery room to welcome in a new niece or nephew. And every child, I think, that has been born into this family since then has been witnessed by a whole slew of people, family and friends alike. I'm sure we broke some laws at Florida Hospital, I don't know. There was just this accepted assumption that we were all welcome at the birth of our nieces and nephews. In the Fulbright family, life from birth all the way through death is truly a family event. Over the next 12 years, Rob and Yvonne brought three more beautiful girls into the world. Sophia Louise on March 15, 2002, Isabella Marie on June 30, 2004, and Victoria Yvonne on October 26, 2012. These four beautiful daughters were the love of Rob's life. His time away from work for the past 16 years has been devoted to raising young ladies who are simply becoming reflectors of Jesus. As has already been mentioned, Rob was well known for hauling a variety of musical instruments all over Central Florida. Girls, he was so proud of your love for music and the talent you share wherever you go. He was also famous for leading the cheer section for his daughter's volleyball games at Forest Lake Academy. Someday you might want to get on Facebook and find the video that was posted on Facebook of Rob leading the fan section in "Let me hear your crazy panther, what's that you say?" It puts a new spin on things we do for our children. But that wasn't unusual for Rob. His passions were mostly wrapped up in the passions and pursuits of his four precious kids. Of course, Rob did have passions of his own. Golf was one of his favorites. One of my personal favorite memories is of our Fulbright foursome that came together for a variety of golf tournaments from Orlando. In spite of what Mike says, Rob was usually our most consistent player. You also couldn't spend time with Rob without knowing of his passion for all Kansas City sports. He loved his Royals. He loved his Chiefs. And he loved his Arkansas Razorbacks. And as he carved out a life here in Orlando, the Magic became one of his favorite teams. But above all this, we all remember Rob as a simple man of God. He approached his faith the same way he approached the rest of his life, with dedication, passion, and a simple desire to be better than the day before. In reflecting on the life they built together, Yvonne had these words she wishes more than anything to say to Rob. "Robert D., you are without a doubt the best person I have ever known, and I can't wait for resurrection morning and to see Jesus' face shining upon us as we wrap each other up in our eternal embrace. Thank you, Rob, for choosing me," she said. "Our four beautiful treasures and I will count it a daily joy to spend the rest of our God-given days celebrating the legacy of you." His family said goodbye to Rob on Tuesday afternoon, April 11, 2017, as he went to sleep in the arms of Jesus. Rob is survived by his wife, Yvonne, his daughters, Allie, Sophie, Bella, and V, his parents, Rodney and Harriet Fulbright, his grandmother, Marie Fulbright, his brother, Michael Fulbright, his sister, Michelle Young, and her husband, Robert, and their children, Robbie and Carly, his sister, Shauna, and her husband, Jeff, and their children, Connor and Riley. Rob also leaves behind family treasured on his wife Yvonne's side, including Susan, Harold, and the extended Theobald family, Coral, Dusty, Jareen, and Gerald Miller, Audrey, Bob, Robbie, Bethany, Eliza, Randy, Chantel, and Katie Folkenberg, Lynn, Jim, Morgan, and Whitney Almack, and many other cherished family members. We, his family, passionately look forward to the resurrection and being reunited with our loving husband, father, brother, brother-in-law, and friend. Until that day, even so, come Lord Jesus, soon.
It was my great joy to have hired Rob Fulbright fresh out of Southern Adventist University. Rob and I worked together for 4 years in Nashville and then the past 18 years here in Orlando. Rob was a wise hire, but the interview was unique. Rob always loved to tell this story, and he did so far better than I am able to. Rob and I connected in the latter part of his senior year and agreed that we would have a face-to-face interview at Southern after I completed taking the LSAT, which is the law school admission test that was being provided at Southern. The evening before the exam, I drove from Nashville to Collegedale and stayed with my brother, who lived in the area. The next morning, my brother's house was without water. I was unable to shower, so I dressed in sweatpants, sweatshirt, a baseball hat, and went to take this day-long standardized exam. After the test, Rob and I met in this incredibly small office there at Southern. Rob dressed in that senior awkward interview suit, and I in my sweats. And I would also add that my brain was numb after taking that exam, and really a poor strategy to interview such a potential star at that point in my day. Somehow we made it through the interview, and Rob accepted the position. Later, we'd often joke about that setting and my attire, and then I would remind Rob that one of us in the interview already had a job. And Rob joined our team at Tennessee Christian Medical Center, and Susie and I and our three sons fell in love with him. He was a delight to have on the team. Excuse me. He was a quick learner and a hard worker. Another member of the team there at Tennessee Christian dubbed Rob Project Boy, which wasn't particularly flattering, but it was probably accurate for the work I gave him to do during those early years. We had a lot of fun together. Rob and I would golf. He was always much better at that than I was. And we had a host of good memories in those times. My three sons were 10 plus years younger than Rob. And they were awed by this cool, single college graduate that at that time drove a white Thunderbird. He was always generous to them. And my sons have grown up looking to Rob as a role model. And I thank Rob for that. It was an honor to be Rob's mentor. It started early and continued. Rob was always quick to affirm this mentoring relationship. He was eager to learn, would take great counsel, would read what I would recommend to him. But it was a two-way street. He inspired me. We had many lengthy conversations about work, about leadership, about Christian faith, and personal development. And then when Rob described this young lady from Kentucky, Yvonne, that he was interested in and planning on marrying, we had conversations about building a lasting marriage. In 96, Rob joined the Florida Hospital team, and 4 years later, as Florida Hospital recruited me, it was Rob who picked me up from the hotel and toured me around Orlando. And we were reunited as colleagues. It was a joyful experience watching Rob grow from this college guy to a loving, God-inspired leader, husband, and father. However, Rob's perspective changed while attending a Christian-based leadership development program called LifeWorks Leadership. During that program, one of the required readings was Oz Guinness's powerful book entitled The Call. It became Rob's favorite book. In particular, he was drawn to the chapter and concept of the audience of one. Rob understood his calling to be a life lived listening to the decisive call of God is a life lived before the audience of one. That affected Rob's priorities, and he reframed them where Jesus was first, his audience, his family second, and work third. Rob loved his wife passionately, faithfully, and unconditionally. And he loved his four graceful, talented daughters. Recently, Rob's father shared with me that the two of them, Rob and he, used to spend all day Sundays golfing. And they actually had a particular technique of avoiding the starter. And I think that was also avoiding paying. And they would play all day. And Rob, as we know, was quite good at that. However, when the girls were born, Rob redirected his Sundays to be spent with his family. Now, when the girls were younger, they would arrive at church where Rob and I and our families attended church together. They would arrive dressed alike with significant bows in their hair. They were beautiful and delightful. And I would always ask Rob why he was not wearing a bow. And he would quickly point out that he would need hair. Rob was a friend to all, highly affirming and clear in his thinking. His warm smile and quick humor were always present. There are so many funny stories about Rob. Great sense of humor, and I was reflecting on some of those stories, and I now see that I always felt better after being around him. And I know that goes for everyone in this room. As a leader, I saw Rob develop a passion for execution, patient experience, employee engagement, and clinical excellence. But above all, he worked tirelessly to build a culture that reflected the healing ministry of Christ. A warm culture of high respect, high trust, high compassion, and high performance. As we've heard, Rob's family is a family of faith. He inspired me with his commitment to his mother and father, brother, sisters, brother-in-law, and Yvonne's family. In our mentoring sessions, we would talk about how he was encouraging his family. Rob's dad, is a strong, steady, and anchored in God's love, has provided leadership and a continuing example to the entire family. Rob created a legacy which, while cut way too short, is one that will have broad and lasting impact. And his impact is vast. He and his family have touched all of us. Rob would want us all to know that belief and love for God is the starting point, the true north throughout the journey, and the final resting place. Susie and I want to join with all of his friends to affirm our love for him by committing to support the family as they face an uncertain future. Rob had great faith, and all of us look forward to that day when we will be reunited with him. Tuesday, as I sat next to Rob's damaged body, I was reflecting on how his soul is made perfect through Christ. I leaned over to him and quoted Matthew 25 to Rob. I said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. And thank you for being my friend and making my life so rich." Excuse me. Rob had an extensive work family that loved him and loved working with him. We have a short video from a few of the many people he worked with, and they wanted to share with all of us what Rob meant to them. Thank you.
Sharon and I have had the privilege of knowing both Rob and Yvonne from the late 1980s when they both were in Nashville. Rob was obviously a people person, and he knew how to connect with people, and I believe that was one of his absolutely unique gifts. So we're going to miss Rob an unbelievable amount. This is a huge loss to Adventist Health System, and we just want to keep leaning on each other, and especially on the family right now.
I got to know Rob in 2006 when I first came to the state of Florida to work, but I really got to know Rob this past year. We were both volleyball dads, and there was no dad better than Rob when he went to a volleyball game. And he was the cheerleader team for the parents. So he taught me this cheer. Here it goes. Boom, kitty, kitty, boom, kitty, kitty, boom. Rob was in his element when he was with family and friends.
Well, one of the many things that I really admired about Rob was his ability to take what he does seriously, but not take himself very seriously. His passion for excellence and quality in the work that he did, but with that joy and the funness that he put into all of his work. We're gonna miss you, Rob.
I will always remember Rob for his infectious smile. Rob was truly a unique individual in that he understood what drove physicians, and he understood what it meant to have a true relationship with physicians. Rob will truly be missed because of his unique ability to connect and his truly down-to-earth nature.
So my memories of Rob is actually during my recruitment and my visits here doing consulting. And Rob was one of the reasons why I came to Florida Hospital. It was his vision, his passion, his ability to assemble clinical teams and provider teams, and his energy and enthusiasm. He was a wonderful guy.
When I think about Rob, he has so many strengths, and he led from a place of his strengths, building a culture, crafting mission-driven performance, creating a message that would rally a team and be able to engage them. And I am so saddened by his loss and yet so thankful for the time that we had together and the impact that he's made on my life and so many lives around our company and then in this community.
The gift that Rob brought to me as a leader and to us at the Altamont team was his ability to connect extending the healing ministry of Christ to the outcomes in the organization. And I'll always be thankful for him for having those passions connect and motivating us through mission.
I remember Rob for reminding me the meaning of numbers, not just metrics to show on a chart or graph, but every metric means a family that we're impacting the community. So that was the reason why we did what we did.
So in July of 2011, Rob hired me to be the CEO at Florida Hospital Apopka. And he told me that Verby had this vision for 20 years to create a full service hospital. And he said, but we're not sure how we're gonna fund it or where it's gonna be, but go out there and perform the best that you can and we'll figure it out. And he took that vision that Verby had and made it compelling. And I believe that we're moving into a new Florida Hospital Apopka today because of Rob.
So I probably learned 1,000 things from Rob over my years with him, and I'm gonna miss out on easily another 1,000 because he's gone too soon. But one of the things that I will always remember the most about Rob was the way he connected with people and empowered them to do things that they didn't think were possible. Whether it was on a town hall stage with 300 employees, charging them up about performance and the way they could do better, whether it was a room full of physicians, connecting with them and telling them that they could solve their problems and they could be successful and then helping them do it, or a room full of executives having a tough conversation that pushed each one of us to be better. Rob was great at that, and you always left the room with no doubt that you were going to be successful.
So Rob is a friend, a mentor, and in many ways a role model. I've learned a lot from Rob over the years. The first thing that jumps out to me is I've learned about generosity. Rob's taught us to be generous with our time and with our affection. Rob has taught us that when you're clear about your principles, your priorities are easy to identify. He's also taught us that people matter and that if you want to build a strong culture, the people you work with have to know it.
I have known Rob for a long time, but I had a conversation with him many years ago when his girls were still very young. And I asked him how he was balancing life. And I had struggled with that as a young executive. And so he sat and explained to me his priorities and how God and family were his number one priority. And yet, the creative ways in which he would attend to his family needs and still meet all of his work requirements. And I remember leaving that conversation wishing it had happened 10 years earlier.
The thing I especially admire about Rob is his humility. Any day of the week, you could see him walking through the hallways and greeting every employee by name. He treated them like family. And his legacy and the culture he created has stood the test of time.
Rob was the first CEO I worked for, and he taught me what it was to be an executive. I watched employees for new orientation meet with him one-on-one almost every week, and there wasn't a single employee who didn't walk out of his office without a smile. And he really showed me what it was to connect with people on such a personal level in such a short amount of time, and I appreciate every moment I was able to spend working with him and for him.
So I've had the privilege and honor to work with Rob for 9.5 years. And I think one of the most beautiful things I've taken away from working alongside him for all these years is how he was the same person at work in his core that he was at home. There are no words that I could say that will ever properly express my appreciation for the impact that he's had in my life. To work for a man that so beautifully modeled authentic leadership has been a joy.
As I reflect on 16 years of experiences with Rob, I'm reminded of his energy levels, his bias for action, his sense of humor, a humor that would show up in virtually every situation and encounter you would have with Rob. It's clear he had a profound effect on this community. I know he had a profound effect on me.
I had the privilege of working with Rob in the East Region for just over a year. I got to know Rob very well, appreciated very much the talents and the gifts that he brought. His exuberance, his optimism, his enthusiasm, his resilience was something that was infectious. For me, my life will never be the same. And Rob Fulbright was one of the kindest and noblest men I've ever known. Thank you, Rob, for touching my life. You'll be missed.
One thing that I always appreciated most is he was a transparent leader with a sense of humor, and I feel that that's very important, and ultimately it got people at all levels to not only like him, but love him as their leader as well.
Rob was an amazing leader, one of the truly authentic leaders. He connected with people on such a real level, knew them, knew their names, knew what was going on in their lives. He developed relationships and connections, and that made people follow him. He was an incredible, authentic leader who brought out the best in all of us, and his loss is significant, and he will be missed.
Once Rob came into orientation, and he did this all the time, but he sat down next to an employee, and he said, "How are you doing?" And they just smiled, and they said, "A little nervous." And he said, "Yeah, I'm a little nervous too." And he talked to him for a few minutes, and he was even a little late for starting, but it didn't matter because he was in the moment. And he got up, and he introduced himself, and I saw the look on that employee's face. And I knew it was special to them, and they realized who he was as a person, and that's who Rob was.
I'm not very good in moments like these, and I often struggle with finding the right words, which was the opposite of Rob. He always seemed to find exactly the right thing to say. Whether he was inspiring employees at a town hall meeting, uniting the team in the conference room, or mentoring a friend. But I think the most important thing I learned from Rob is staying true to your values and protecting what's really important in this life. He will always serve as a role model to me in the fact that he never compromised when it came to his family, his friends, or to God.
It was Rob's vision that we would all wear our hearts on the outside where people could see them. That vision became a reality with a badge pull that represented our hearts. And each employee wore one of these hearts. And they would say, "I care for you like I care for my daughter, Brooke." Or, "I care for you like I care for my friend, Rob." And Rob's heart said, "I care for you like I care for my wife, Yvonne." My heart is broken, but it's filled with love, passion, and a drive to live out Rob's legacy, and I will always lead with my heart.
I think of Rob as a man who is genuine. Rob is a friend. Rob is someone who was a leader because he wasn't afraid to push for things to be better. And he was always someone I looked forward to seeing. When you'd see Rob coming down the hall, or you knew you had a meeting coming up with Rob, you knew you were gonna finish the day better than it started.
Rob was full of life. I loved doing things with Rob, and one of the favorite pictures I have is several of us sitting on a pit box and Rob giving the camera that cheesy grin he gave everybody when they walked in the door. I love that about Rob. Rob was the consummate professional. He always wanted things to be better. His leadership style and his attitude of making everything he touched get better will always be remembered and will be a legacy that we'd never forget.
Rob,
Rob, Rob, Rob.
Harriet, you said the other day that Rob was an accident. It was a good accident. Thank you. Thank you, Rodney, for that good, great, awesome night moment that you created. I believe that grieving is the gift of remembrance. So I want to remember Rob. And I want to say, and I want to frame it by reading this verse for each of you in the Fulbright family. It's found in Matthew chapter 3, verse 17. This is from the Message. This is my son, chosen and marked by my love, delight of my life. Those are the words of a father to a son. Harriet, that's your boy that we see up there. Your beloved son. The Heavenly Father said about his son that he grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and all the people. Harriet, that's your boy. These words are for your boy, your son. Yvonne, those are the words for your man. He is also, Harriet, God's boy. And he's also God's man, Yvonne. And girls, this is your daddy. These words are for your daddy from Jesus, Abba, his daddy. In a very difficult moment in my life, Rob came into my life. And he came into my life and brought in Yvonne and Allie and Sophie and Bella in a few years. Then he brought Victoria, bags of blessings, and this amazing life. He enriched my life. I remember when unofficially he interviewed me. This was months before anything happened. And into the interview, about halfway, he said these words to me, which I have never forgotten. These are his words. For the last 2 years, Sergio, a question has been troubling me, haunting me day and night. It doesn't leave me alone. One day, he said, God is going to ask me, I gave you 1,800 employees. What did you do to bring them into my kingdom? When he said those words, I said, Rob, I'm not gonna let you continue. Can I just say a few words? And I said, that is a God-given vision. God called God called and gave Rob a vision. It wasn't just a vision to work in healthcare. It wasn't just to be a successful administrator. He became a man who responded to a greater calling. And Rob was fully aware and fully awake to that calling. He was captivated. He became captive for that God-given vision. He captured that vision. He embraced that vision and made it his own. And like the prophet Jeremiah, he became a fire in his bones, his heart and his soul. And it was this fire, this thing inside of him that drove him, led him, guided him. Rob caught a God-given vision. So Rob had his eyes in eternity, the eternal value of human beings. People matter to Rob because people matter to God. Every encounter with someone was being the presence of God to that person. No, it wasn't about preaching. It was about being present and being a presence. And he said these words that same day in the interview. He said, "I want my employees, if they ever leave the hospital, I want them to say, my life was enriched by working here." And every single employee that would leave knew that. Rob was a very spontaneous person. One day, Dawn, who was our director of the foundation at Altamont, she had asked me to have an opening prayer for this breakfast for civic leaders. I was very new in hospital work. I came from doing youth ministry, which is another troubling experience. So I was nervous. So I had actually spent, I would always tell Rob, you know, Rob, I've been up to 2 a.m, you know, thinking about this. And I had written out my prayer. So he comes in just a few minutes before this civic leader's breakfast is supposed to start. He says, "Sergio, is there a printed program with your name on it?" I said, "Look, I haven't seen one." "Well, you know, because I feel impressed to pray this morning." God-given vision. This is what he says. "I want them to see Jesus as the center of all we do here. I want them to hear it from me." He was supposed to give the welcome. So he said, I said, "Rob, they expect for a religious person to pray. They expect a chaplain to pray. But you go out there, because the least thing that people will expect from the CEO of any hospital is to get up there, give them the welcome, and have the opening prayer. You go out there and you represent the love of your life." He did. He did so beautiful. I stood in the back, moved and touched that this amazing son of yours, Harriet, and this man of yours, Ivan, was doing that kind of courageous act on behalf of the kingdom. There was an issue with administrators. There is an issue with administrators and scores, right? Everybody wants good scores, you know, Gallup and all that stuff. Let me just say a few words about that and Rob. The scores for Rob were only important because they made God look good. Because our mission is to extend the healing ministry of Christ. So we need to measure up to that. Becoming a world-class hospital was an aspiration and important because he served a world-class God and he wanted to show him off. He would always remind the A-team, the Florida Hospital Altamont team. We may not be able to cure everyone that comes to our hospital, but we can bring healing and wholeness to their lives. And then there was bags of blessings. His own little ministry with his family. Bella, I don't know if you remember this. I can't see you because the flowers are here in front of me. But I remember in these living room discussions that we had, these brainstorm sessions about bags of blessings. And I remember little Bella saying, you know, we were trying to change the name. Remember that process? Bags of blessing. Bella, you know, says, why don't we call bags to inspire? And everybody said, yeah, that's it, bags to inspire. Well, Bella, you were describing your daddy. He was both inspirational and inspiring. He breathed life into people, which is basically what it means to be a spiritual person. Earthy human being, imperfect human beings, broken human beings, infused with the breath of God life, and infusing and breathing life into others. And then I just want to say a word about our mission trip to Mexico. One day I told Rob, you know, Rob, why don't we just have breakfast one day? And he's been wanting to have breakfast with me, so I said, why don't we go to the Tortilleria Mexicana in Apopka? So we agreed and we met there. I'm not gonna tell you where it is because then you're gonna hold it against me. My daughters counsel me, don't take them there. But we went there. He had never had chips and salsa for breakfast. And then when I ordered guacamole for breakfast, he was even more estranged. But we have huevos rancheros, and he says, I'll order whatever you order. So that's what we had. And we talked about the kingdom, about his kingdom, the kingdom of God. Last year, after several years, Rob and his family were able to come with me to this mission trip that I do in beautiful Cancun. You may laugh, because everybody laughs when I say I go to Cancun for a mission trip. But I want to tell you something. We go to the poorest of the poorest little neighborhoods in Cancun. That evening, or after we arrived there, Rob came up to me, and he said that he was going in the bus, and when we arrived there in the bus, he kept wondering, what in the world I'm doing here? What did I get into with Sergio? The bus was air conditioned, comfortable. but it wasn't when the bus was not able to go any further that he began to realize where he was. And it wasn't until he heard these little Mexican kids singing a welcome song where their balloons and their makeshift signs of welcome, brothers and sisters, thank you for coming, that his heart broke and his throat choked and he simply could not hold back the tears. He even did that when he was telling me about it. And then he said, I knew why I was here. So there he is, on the scaffolding in Cancun. You see him? He's right above the sign. Dirty, stinking, sweating, with his girls, with his wife, with teenagers, with young adults, building a simple roof for Jesus, once again fulfilling his mission in life. After I heard Rob many times in town halls, I said, you know, Rob, you and I should go on tour. You know, we can do it. We can do a pretty good preaching team, you know, and you preach and I preach. He said, Serge, I can't preach. I said, you sure can. When you get up and do so many sessions of this town hall, I don't know what you call it, but you really get excited, you know, and yeah, you throw up the numbers, but you say something more. You inspire people. So I could never get him to preach. And he had so much to say. But I finally got him. He had no choice. So there he is doing it. I said, Rob, I'll interpret for you. And God gave me that opportunity. I got him to do it. And this week, Yvonne, I broke the news to Danielle, who is our person in Cancun. And the comment that he made is, I just cannot forget Rob's message that morning. So, Rob, this accident in Rodney and Harriet's life has created a revolution. I call it the Rob Revolution. And he got you, because this inspiring leader had the capacity to reproduce his life in the life of other people. So, we have the Fulbrights, and we have the Gibsons, and we have these clans of people who are fully committed to the vision of making a difference in the world. The vision that Rob lived and moved is too big to miss out on it. So I'm gonna invite you to join the Rob Revolution. We can be builders of God's kingdom. We can change the world. We can transform Florida. We can change Orlando, our neighborhoods and communities. We, like Rob, can be the presence of Jesus with every person that we meet. We can make a difference. We can be restorers. We can love people. We can make people first. We can bring God's healing love to broken people. We can today recommit to being devoted and passionate about bringing healing to people. We can breathe life into people, because that's exactly what Rob did. And for us, as a health system, we are a service organization that serves people. not patients, not clients, not associates, not employees, people, persons created in the image and likeness of God, people considered by God sacred, people who are God's treasure possession. So I'm going to invite you, take out your smartphones and sign up. The hashtag is, I'm in the Rod Revolution. A revolution of compassion, a revolution of love, a revolution of grace. This is our boy, Grace. This is God, Harriet. This is God's boy. God's legacy of faith lived very well through the life of Rob Fulbright. That life continues. It's not over. The life of this man is not over. It's just beginning. Thank you, Harriet. Thank you, Rodney. Thank you, Yvonne and the girls. We're with you. Let's get the Rob Revolution going. God bless you.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, you can have all this world, give me Jesus. And when I am alone, and when I am alone, and when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, you can have all this world, give me Jesus. And when I come to
Who was Robert Don Fulbright to me? He was my dad. He was my rock and my biggest fan. The adored leader he was in this community was the same adored father I loved and admired at home. I will never forget our early morning drives to my grandma's house. We always read together a chapter of the Bible and his favorite devotional, My Utmost for His Highest. He was a spiritual giant in my life and always will be. I want to love Jesus as much as he did. My dad loved Adele since her first album came out in 2008. I remember my sisters and I singing duets with him every time her songs came on the radio. He always told us she'd be famous one day, and sure enough, she is. We went to one of her concerts last summer, and here my dad walks in with five girls. Every comment he got about the cost of weddings or giving up on having a boy, his response was always, "Are you kidding me? I'm the luckiest guy ever. They treat me like a king." I remember him saying, "I love you," every time he kissed me goodnight. We gave each other butterfly kisses, and I told him that I danced with him to that song at my wedding. I could count on him. He always supported me through my accomplishments and failures. He expected me to do my best, even when I forgot what that was. I wouldn't be who I am today without him. There's so much life I needed to live with him. I can't imagine what it's going to be like moving forward, but I know Jesus will carry us through it. Mom, I just want to say that I love you. You're the strongest woman I know, and your relationship with God has been incredible and such a testimony inspiration to me. And Sophie, Belle, and Victoria, as your oldest sister, I want to make this commitment before you and God that I will try always to be the kind of older sister that Dad would want me to be.
There are thousands upon thousands of reasons why I love my daddy. He meant the world to me. He taught me how to lead compassionately, believe wholeheartedly, love unendingly, serve unselfishly, forgive fully, and live gracefully. He had every characteristic you would ever want in a father, friend, and husband. He meant everything to me. From the moment I entered his life, he never stopped showing Christ through his actions. He was a spiritual role model for me and never ceased to encourage me towards Jesus. Even the morning before his incident, my dad had an intentional conversation with me about God's calling in my life. As we closed, he enveloped me in one of his huge bear hugs and prayed for me. That moment will never be forgotten. My daddy was so incredibly selfless. He never pushed his agenda and always wanted to do whatever the family was doing. No matter if he had just come home from work, was relaxing on a Sabbath afternoon, was getting takeout, or even about to turn on the TV, he always asked, "What do the girls want?" He put us before him and never complained. I cannot count how many times my dad sat on the couch with all five of his girls to watch princess movies, chick flicks, or even Barney and Friends. Family was what my daddy's life was centered around. He loved us immensely and cared for us deeply. He made us each feel special and considered us girls his hobbies. Whenever he would come and snuggle with me in my bed, he would always sing Little Surfer Girl. Though I'm not much of a surfer, every time he would sing Do You Love Me, Do You Surfer Girl, my heart would melt. Whenever he would leave, he would always rub my ear and I would rub his head, a tradition that started years ago. His nicknames such as Soph and Sophie Lou will never be forgotten in my heart and are a reminder of the connection we had. It was almost as if he grew up with me, I remember when I was little, Daddy would be right by my side playing tea party with me, or climbing under a sheet fort to play make-believe, or even pretending to be my prince. As I got older, he would spend countless hours swimming in the pool, reading books, dancing to Mariah Carey, and playing outside with the animals, around the barn, or even digging in the dirt. When I entered my teen years, he leaned in even closer and became my most loyal friend. He was there for everything, banquets, orchestra performances, hair appointments, volleyball games, nail painting, shopping sprees, Sunday night football, late night talks, prayers, and encouragement. As much as he loved my mom and us, we loved him. I remember every night we would wait at home until he got there to have his supper as a united family. Our lives were not complete without each other. Daddy, as I look back on all the memories we made together, I'm overwhelmed about how completely you loved. You show me what life's greatest priorities are and have shaped me to become the person I am today. I will cherish the memory of your smile and the way you made me laugh. You've impacted me and other people far more than you could ever imagine, but for me, your impact on my life is what is most amazing. I'm so proud to be your Sophie Lou. Love you to the moon and back a million times.
My daddy has always been there for me. Whether I needed help with school, someone to hug, or a goofy joke to make me laugh, Daddy was the person I loved to go to. Before going to bed each night, he would puff up his cheeks and then I would pop them. I would put my hand under his chin, pretending to feed what we called the puffer fish. He made delicious omelets, took us on fabulous trips, went to NASCAR races and bundles of sporting events, and took me to beautiful galas. I remember driving back in the car, listening to him sing me to sleep, and I felt like a princess as I leaned on him. My dad was selfless, protective, loyal, adored my mom, and loved God and his family with all of his heart. But most importantly, he was a huge spiritual mentor in my life. If someone would ask me right now why I miss my dad so much, I would tell them that it was because he was completely wonderful. He was the person I could run to. He would watch over me and spiritually formed me. I wish I could tell him that I loved him one last time, and I don't understand why he has passed so soon, but I know that he will embrace me with Jesus in heaven. Even though it seems like my journey with Daddy has ended, it actually has just begun. He helped shape me for eternity. I love you, Daddy, with all of my heart, and I can't wait to see you someday soon to have your strong arms surround me. Love, Bella Boo.
Victoria, she was gonna say something, but I'll say it for her. No, okay. She just wanted to say that she loves her daddy and that she misses him.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Joel Hightower. Real quick, I want to just acknowledge the Florida Hospital flight crew. So great to see you guys here in uniform. As the oldest of the nephews and nieces, just wanted to share a little thought on how much Rob means to us. You also, in the back of your minds, might be wondering why our ties look so fly. It's because they're Uncle Rob's. My memory is attending Daytona 500 this past spring with Rob and Yvonne, and early in the morning we showed up and got to take a lap in the race car, and I got to ride with Rob and Yvonne, and I hope I can do a lap around the pearly gates with Rob and Yvonne someday soon.
Among the many memories I have of my Uncle Rob,
we really did love him a lot.
The one that stands out was his infectious smile and laugh. There was never a dull moment when he was in the room. He was always smiling, goofing around, and either laughing with you or at you. I can't wait for that day when I get to hear his laugh and see his smile again.
Two memories of Uncle Rob I have. One was when I was really young, I looked at him and I said, "So do you cut your hair to look like that?" He informed me that he does not cut his hair to look like that. And my second memory, and probably one of my favorites, is no matter where we are driving or where we went, whenever Uncle Rob was sitting in the front seat, he would always reach over and hold Auntie Vaughn's hand.
My one memory of many with Uncle Rob has to be when he was leading the cheer squad again with the Fulbright clan at my baseball game. And I just remember looking over and seeing that smiley face in the stands and him just rooting and roaring and having the best time. And I'm going to love him and I'm going to see him again.
When I think of my favorite memory I have of Uncle Rob, I think of the stupid little nicknames he used to always give me when I was little. Well, the biggest one that always stuck with the family was Con Man, which I hate that nickname, but, you know, out of all those stupid nicknames and those stupid jokes, I'm gonna cherish them and I'm gonna miss them.
Well, Uncle Rob seemed to have a thing with giving people names, and that for sure is my favorite memory. Anytime he would see me or briefly pass me, it was actually really annoying. He would always go, "Katie, Katie, 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 Katie." Anytime, even if it was just passing me for a second, he would always do that, and I will miss him and that annoying little thing he would do.
Growing up, my family either lived on the other side of the world or the other side of the country. So our times together were fewer and farther between, but they will never be forgotten. So many memories, but probably my favorite that initially I hardly remember took place in Thailand as Auntie Vaughn and Uncle Rob came over and spent some time with my family. We rode elephants and floated down rivers on bamboo rafts, and somewhere along that trip, we adopted, or Uncle Rob came up with this chant, "We're going to the marble temple." And it was kind of odd. And I will tell you, every single time we got together since then, he would always look over at us and be like, "We're going to the marble temple." And there was something about Uncle Rob that no matter what the situation, no matter where you were, he made you feel valued. He made you feel important and he made you feel loved, and that is something that I will never forget. I think one of the reasons that we as nieces and nephews wanted to share something up here is to let our cousins know how much Uncle Rob meant to all of us. We loved our time with him. and we're going to miss him. Uncle Rob was always in the thick of things, more specifically in the thick of wherever the fun was happening. And whether any time we were together, he was out in the back with us throwing the football, jumping in the pool. Such great memories, and I think that endeared him to all of us, didn't it? That's something that I've seen at just through this program, is how he did his best to go out of his way so that each person knew that he or she was special and important to him and to other people. And so for that, he is close to our heart. And he's there because we know that we were close to his. And our prayers and our thoughts are always going to be with you all.
If it wasn't apparent to you before you came in this morning, by now you realize that my brother's legacy is massively overrated. You already probably realize by now, too, that my biggest spiritual leading edge, and it's developed over the last 15 or 20 years, is what it's like to live in a constant inferiority complex. I want to start by just saying again a special thank you, Terry Shaw, Andy McDonald, my brother-in-law Jeff, for being the family administrator this week. Huge help. My buddy, Rob's college roommate, Bob Martin, for coming and sharing music with us. Terry Owen, thank you for sharing memories. Thank you to the Florida Hospital family for that absolutely fantastic video, for all that you've meant in Rob's life. Sergio, thank you. Your authenticity, your realness, your close walk with Jesus. It's an inspiration. Sebastian, dude, you can sing. Ali, Soph, Bella, V, for sharing. Courage takes to do that. Rob's nieces and nephews, thanks, guys, for your thoughts. And thanks to Jeff Patterson as well for his participation this morning. I want to start, I'll continue by saying that I cannot overstate in any way, shape, or form how much it means to have every single one of you here. Your presence this afternoon means more than you will ever know. This room is in itself right now a living, breathing testament and a comforting affirmation to my family of my brother's legacy, character, and influence, if I can brag on him for just a moment here. Okay, I'm done for now. The body of Christ in its many, many various shapes and forms is a powerful thing. And by the way, I just realized I forgot one other thank you. I want to say thank you to our friends at Calvary of Orlando, our brothers and sisters in Christ, generously opened your facility today on Good Friday. Thank you. Thank you for the truckload of ways, all of you, the truckload of ways that you have demonstrated your love for us as a family over the last few days, and it's been nothing short of simply stunningly spectacular. We love you, and words will never express how much your love means to us as a family. Before we talk a little bit about Jesus and God and his role and thoughts in this whole deal, I did want to laugh for just a second. Being the pastoral brother, they give me the share the hope, do the scripture thing, and that's all good. I'm totally cool with that. But I need to share with you one little tiny story before I do that. And it has to do with Rob's passion for golf, the male side of the Fulbright family's passion of golf. And you'd think with all we played that Dad and I would be better. We're not. Rob was the one who always carried the crew. But I want to tell you the short story about playing golf at Orange Lake Country Club probably 20 years ago. And John Machado was the fourth member of the foursome that day. Me, Rob, Dad, John. And it is a Fulbright tradition that from the 18th hole back to the clubhouse is always a drag race. And it's a no-holds-barred drag race. And this particular day, we played golf at Orange Lake Country Club. There had been a ton of rain. And we dropped the starting flag and off we went. And we came near to the finish line and there was a giant mud puddle. Both carts side by side. As they say in NASCAR, if you ain't rubbing, you ain't racing. We were rubbing and racing. I don't remember for sure who was driving. Dad had just bought a brand spanking new pair of white golf shoes. Brand new. And both carts were bearing down on the puddle. And nobody was given an inch. And I thought to myself, this is not going to end well. We got to the puddle. Nobody gave an inch. Both carts hit the puddle, full throttle. Muddy, nasty water everywhere. All over our clothes, all over our equipment, all over Dad's shoes. And he was not happy. Dad also had recently purchased a brand new Ford Ranger pickup truck, which Rob and I had traveled down in. And we're looking at our mess, and Dad just steely-eyed. For those of you that know Coach Fulbright, he can do the steely-eyed stare, and you're done. You're just toast, lit up right there. And Dad says to Rob and I, he looks at us both and he says, "You're not getting in that truck with those clothes on." And I looked at Rob and Rob looked at me. And we began to strip down. All the way down, and this is before either he or I had made the manly jump to boxers. We both stripped down to our tidy whiteies. Some of you probably don't want to let that visual image rest too long. I looked at him and he looked at me. We threw the clothes in the back of the truck. The tidy whiteys were the only thing that we had that was clean. And we climbed into the front of that Ford Ranger, looked at how tinted the windows were and said, "They're not tinted nearly enough." And we had to drive all the way from basically Lake Buena Vista to Altamont Springs on I-4 in nothing but our tidy whiteys in the front of that Ford Ranger pickup. And I said, "Rob, if we get pulled over, the family name is done." So 20 years ago, if you ever heard anything about the I-4 Tidy Whitey Bandits, now you know who they were. Our pain is overwhelming today. Pain has been overwhelming all week. I didn't know until this week that heartache is a literal word. An actual ache, a hole. So many of you have shared that you've felt the same. The Apostle Paul asked in one of his New Testament letters, "Death, where is your sting?" And today I think to myself, well, Paul, being that you ask, it seems to be everywhere right now. Everywhere. I think of Jesus standing before the tomb of his good friend Lazarus, and he wept. He wept. And that's always befuddled me a bit, being that he knew in mere moments he would be bringing Lazarus back from the grave. But I'd like to think that at least in some degree that afternoon, he was weeping not only for Lazarus, but for us. Jesus understood, Jesus understands the sting of death. But here's where I'm going to put my stake in the ground this afternoon. I'm going to put my stake in the ground that Jesus knew exactly what he was talking about and was simply on the money when he stated profoundly to Martha, Lazarus' sister, grieving Martha, heart-wrenched in pain, Martha, full of questions that weren't getting answers, Martha. I'm going to put my stake in the ground that Jesus knew exactly what he was talking about and was simply on the money when he stated profoundly to Martha at the death of her brother, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die like everyone else, will live again. They are given eternal life for believing in me and will never perish." My brother, like every single one of us in this room this afternoon, was just a tick or two shy of perfection, although I'm biased, and those seem to be pretty small ticks from my vantage point. But the ticks don't concern me. And they don't concern me because I'm going to hang my hat on Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life. And that we all get to come to the Father through him. And I'm convinced beyond the shadow of a doubt that that is exactly where my brother hung his hat as well. He loved Jesus. In fact, Yvonne told us yesterday that she and Rob spent parts of Sunday morning with each of the girls individually talking with each one about what Jesus followership is all about. That's Rob. That's Yvonne. That's my brother. That's where you've already heard that this morning, time and time and time again. On Tuesday, as we gathered around Rob's bed to say goodbye, Jeff Patterson mentioned that Rob had the brain of an administrator, the brain of an administrator, and the heart of a pastor. That was my brother. And Rob was in constant pursuit of what it meant to be surrendered to Jesus more and more with each passing day. Rob wasn't afraid of learning and growing in what it meant to participate in the death to self that Paul talks about so poignantly in Romans 6. And my brother would have been very, very honored to know that he was going to be laid to rest on Good Friday, following in the footsteps of his Jesus, in whose arms he now so peacefully rests. This week, after I took the phone call from home on Sunday night, I began reaching for a passage of Scripture in which to find solace. It's a common one, though most likely for good reason. The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. My waters didn't feel very still on Sunday night, and they've only become more turbulent as the week has gone on. My pastures didn't seem too green on Sunday night, And I'll be honest with you, they don't necessarily feel any greener now. And then in my private reciting of the passage, I came to this. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. As I was mulling this over in my mind, I began reflecting on a little book I read just a year or two ago, a book that Andy gave to me years ago, and I didn't read till just recently. A Shepherd Looks at Psalm 23. And one of the things that God reminded me of through Philip Keller, the author of that book this week, himself a shepherd, is that it's important that we make a very distinctive and clear differentiation. And Allie, Sophie, Bella, V, I want you to hear this clearly. It's incredibly important that we make a very distinctive and clear differentiation between evil and harm. I have been so painfully reminded in losing Rob this week that no one is exempt from harm. And Jesus followers are never promised exemption from harm. In fact, I've taken some small solace this week remembering that so many of Jesus' early devoted followers said goodbye to this life long before their 70, all because they loved their Lord and were ready to lay down their lives for him. Though Rob laid his life down on Tuesday involuntarily, there's no doubt in my mind that he would have done so voluntarily. But I digress just a tad. Here's what I don't want us to miss. Yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, though we will suffer harm, and in ways and at times that are nothing short of brutal and seemingly unfair. Here we go. Nothing in all creation will be able to separate us from the love and good intentions of our Creator God. Nothing. What can we say about such wonderful things as these? Paul writes in Romans 8, if God is for us, who can ever be against us? Can anything separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity? For I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from his love. Death can't, and life can't. The angels can't, and demons can't. Our fears for today and our worries about tomorrow. Even the powers of hell can't keep God's love away. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loves us. When Rob and I and Michelle and Shauna experienced our early growing up years in Northwest Arkansas, we lived in an A-frame house on a hillside overlooking a railroad crossing. Kansas City Southern freight trains would rumble through on a regular basis, shaking the very foundation of the house. I remember the pictures and the plaques on the wall of Rob's and my bedroom would shake, rattle, and roll every time a Kansas City Southern came roaring through at 2 a.m., easily doing 45 miles an hour, just sitting on the horn. Good memories in that house. Great memories in that house. But I'll remember that house as well for one other very poignant memory. One of many good ones, but a poignant one nonetheless. Mom and Dad owned a stereo, but it wasn't like the one we see in homes today. There was actually, the ones we're used to today, there's a receiver, there's a CD player, and I'm even dating myself, I just realized talking about this. receiver, a CD player, maybe two speakers in the room. Now everything's iPad, iPhone. But this was a stereo console, a big wooden thing. Beautiful wood design, dark wood. Speakers built into the wooden cabinet, and inside that cabinet was a record player. A record player. Spins, put a needle on it, it's vinyl. And inside this same stereo, Mom and Dad kept their collections of records. I don't really remember what any of them were, except for one. Tennessee Ernie Ford. And I used to love lying beside that stereo on Friday nights, fire in the fireplace, KC Southern's rolling by, listening to that Tennessee Ernie Ford album. And on that album, this Negro spiritual, "In That Great Getting Up Morning." I'm going to tell you about the coming of the Savior. Fare you well, fare you well. I'm going to tell you about the coming of the Savior. Fare you well, fare you well. There's a better day a-coming. Fare you well, fare you well. In that gray getting up morning, fare you well, fare you well. In that gray getting up morning, fare you well, fare you well. In that gray getting up morning, fare you well, fare you well. In that gray getting up morning, fare you well, fare you well. Yvonne, Allie, Soph, Boo, V, family, friends, while we wait for the physical resurrection and the day we get to see Rob again, let's live lives characterized by resurrection power, lives that will honor Jesus, lives that will honor Rob. Now, brothers and sisters, I want you to know what will happen to the Christians who have died, so you will not be full of sorrow like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus comes, God will bring back with Jesus all the Christians who have died. I'd suggest others as well, who never knew about Jesus. I can tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living when the Lord returns will not rise to meet him ahead of those who are in their graves. But the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the call of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, all the Christians who have died will rise from their graves. Then, together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air and will remain with him forever. So comfort and encourage each other with these words.
Rob and I were in the same high school class, but at rival high schools.
Rob was at Forest Lake Academy, and I was at Collegedale Academy, where Mike was our assistant chaplain under Ken Rogers that year. It was a little spiritual point. We got off on the wrong foot with, I got off the wrong foot with Rob, where we met at a Bible conference at Cotta Springs camp, and I inadvertently hit on his girlfriend, which started a rivalry between us, very friendly. And eventually, when I came down here to Florida, his wonderful, talented girls would be doing these amazing special musics, and he would post it online, and then I would tell the girls that we would have to go to the practice room because the Fulbrights had posted another video. And we love these girls, but what he kept outdoing me. You know, first of all, he had four girls, and I only had two girls. And then he had this one daughter who played the harp. And there was nothing I could do about that. Well, I just have to say about this harp, he was always carrying this harp around. If you saw him at events, you saw Rob. And as a matter of fact, we were here on this stage for Florida Hospital's event last fall, and the Fulbrights were 5 minutes late to rehearsal. And here comes Rob trying to manhandle this harp in through the orchestra. And I snapped a picture of him right here with this harp. And I just am reminded about Rob and this beautiful family and how much he loves these girls and their talent and spent time. I'm so proud of each one of you. As we close, and we just invite you to sing together about this great Resurrection Day.
When sorrows like sea. I want to thank you all for being here to be a part of this service. It's a bit silly to say, because how could you not? So many of us have been impacted by the life of Rob Fulbright. Immediately after this service has concluded, there will be a procession from here to Highland Memorial Garden, where there will be a short service there. But because so many have come to be a part of this, it seems more than obvious we will never get all of our cars in a single line. There is clearance for 90 cars in that line, but if it should work out for you that you are not able to be there yet you still want to go to Highland Memorial Garden, please make your way there and do not feel bad. Immediately following the prayer, the family will together go out through this door. And I would ask that you give them the time to get up and make their way, but then follow them out as they go, because this place has been gracious to afford us this opportunity today, yet they have many other things going on. And so it will be a kindness that we can do for them this weekend to make our way to the next part of our days after this in a quick manner. After the short service at the graveside, the family has requested that the rest of us will then find our ways and disperse, that they might have a few last moments together. And I know we will all want to honor them in this request. So, Yvonne, with your permission, we will conclude this time of honoring Rob. Let us pray. Father in heaven, if you have been listening for the last couple hours, and I know you have, you know that we are perplexed. Because you set among us one who was as a prince among us, who walked with nobility and grace and talent and kindness and love. And now we keep going all those places where we used to find him, and we can't find him there anymore. And we are perplexed and sad. Lord, he has inspired so many of us. As mentioned, the mind of an administrator and the heart of a pastor. And I dare say, Lord, those that are administrators, possibly better than all of us, and those that are pastors, know he was better than all of us. Why was this? Father, it's clear. He was committed to the Lord Jesus, who took all that he was and made him so effective in every way. Lord, help us to take from here that conviction that Rob carried, to put you first in our lives, to look to you, and to follow after Jesus, that we also might be gracious in all we do, and that we also would be committed to our families. And if need be, this day we would make apologies for where we have come short. and that we would be faithful in our work, not despising one another, but rather, like Rob, reflecting the reality of Jesus, loving one another and seeking to do good for each other. Rob has passed beyond for this time, beyond our ability to see and touch and hear. But his distinctive voice I will always remember. And the things he said will go on in our lives and in our hearts. Now, Lord, by your Spirit, draw near to this family, and particularly to Yvonne and Alexandra and Sophia and Isabella and Victoria, a family who in this most difficult of hours has demonstrated such class before us, Lord, by your grace. Lord, be with them. Be their comfort. Be a husband and father to them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
For those of you who are going to the cemetery in escort, we would ask that you turn your lights, flashers on, and your headlights so that they know that you're in a procession. Thank you so much.